Listening Library presents Five Little Peppers and How They Grew by Margaret Sidney. Read for you by Bernadette Dunne.
Chapter 1. A Home View. The little old kitchen had quieted down from the bustle and confusion of midday, and now, with its afternoon manners on, presented a holiday aspect that, as the principal room in the brown house, it was eminently proper it should have. It was just on the edge of twilight, and all the little Peppers, all except Ben, the oldest of the flock, were taking a breathing spell, as their mother called it, which meant some quiet work suitable for the hour. It was all the breathing spell they could remember, however, poor things, for times were hard with them now. The father had died when Phronsie was a baby, and since then Mrs. Pepper had had hard work to scrape together money enough to put bread into her children's mouths and to pay the rent of the little brown house. But she had met life too bravely to be beaten down now, so with a stout heart and a cheery face, she had worked away day after day at making coats and tailoring and mending of all descriptions, and she had seen with pride that couldn't be concealed her noisy, happy brood growing up around her and filling her heart with comfort and making the little brown house fairly ring with jollity and fun. "Poor things," she would say to herself. "They haven't had any bringing up. They've just scrambled up." And then she would set her lips together tightly and fly at her work faster than ever. "I must get learning for 'em some way, but I don't see how." Once or twice she had thought, "Now the time's coming." But it never did. For winter shut in very cold, and it took so much more to feed and warm them that the money went faster than ever. And then, when the way seemed clear again, the store changed hands, so that for a long time she failed to get her usual supply of sacks and coats to make. And that made sad havoc in the quarters and half dollars laid up as her nest egg. But, "Well, it'll come sometime," she would say to herself, "because it must." And so at it again she would fly brisker than ever. To help Mother was the great ambition of all the children, older and younger. But in Polly's and Ben's souls, the desire grew so overwhelmingly great as to absorb all lesser things. Many and vast were their secret plans by which they were to astonish her at some future day, which they would only confide, as they did everything else, to one another. For this brother and sister were everything to each other and stood loyally together through thick and thin. Polly was 10 and Ben 1 year older, and the younger three of the five little Peppers, as they were always called, looked up to them with the intensest admiration and love. What they failed to do couldn't very well be done by anyone. "Oh, dear," exclaimed Polly, as she sat over in the corner by the window, helping her mother pull out basting threads from a coat she had just finished and giving an impatient twitch to the sleeve. "I do wish we could ever have any light, just as much as we want." "You don't need any light to see these threads," said Mrs. Pepper, winding up hers carefully as she spoke on an old spool. "Take care, Polly, you broke that. Thread's dear now." "I couldn't help it," said Polly, vexedly. "It snapped. Everything's dear now, seems to me. I wish we could have, oh, ever and ever so many candles, as many as we wanted. I'd light 'em all, so there, and have it light here one night anyway." "Yes, and go dark all the rest of the year, like as anyway," observed Mrs. Pepper, stopping to untie a knot. "Folks who do so never have any candles," she added sententiously.
"How many d'ye have, Polly?"
asked Joel, curiously laying down his hammer and regarding her with the utmost anxiety. "Oh, 200, said Polly decidedly. I'd have 200 all in a row.
200 candles,
echoed Joel in amazement.
My walkety, what a lot.
Don't say such dreadful words, Joel, put in Polly nervously, stooping to pick up her spool of basting thread that was racing away all by itself. Tisn't nice.
Tisn't worse'n to wish you'd got things you haven't, retorted Joel. I don't believe you'd light 'em all at once, he added incredulously.
Yes, I would too, replied Polly recklessly. 200 of 'em, if I had a chance, all at once, so there, Joey Pepper.
Oh,
said little Davie, drawing a long sigh.
Why, 'twould be just like heaven, Polly. But wouldn't it cost money, though?
I don't care, said Polly, giving a flounce in her chair, which snapped another thread. Oh, dear me. I didn't mean to, Mammy. Well, I wouldn't care how much money it cost. We'd have as much light as we wanted for once, so.
Goodness, said Mrs. Pepper. You'd have the house afire. 200 candles? Who ever heard of such a thing?
Would they burn?
Asked Phronsie anxiously, getting up from the floor where she was crouching with David, overseeing Joel nail on the cover of an old box, and going to Polly's side, she awaited her answer patiently. Burn, said Polly. There, that's done now, Mamsie dear. And she put the coat with a last little pat into her mother's lap. I guess they would, Phronsie pet. And Polly caught up the little girl and spun round and round the old kitchen till they were both glad to stop. Then, said Phronsie, as Polly put her down and stood breathless after her last glorious spin,
I do so wish we might, Polly, oh, just this very one minute.
And Phronsie clasped her fat little hands in rapture at the thought. Well, said Polly, giving a look up at the old clock in the corner, goodness me, it's 5:30, and most time for Ben to come home. Away she flew to get supper. So for the next few moments, nothing was heard but the pulling out of the old table into the middle of the floor, the laying of the cloth, and all the other bustle attendant upon the getting ready for Ben. Polly went skipping around, cutting the bread and bringing dishes, only stopping long enough to fling some scraps of reassuring nonsense to the two boys, who were thoroughly dismayed at being obliged to remove their traps into a corner. Phronsie still stood just where Polly left her.
200 candles! Oh, what could it mean?
She gazed up to the old beams overhead and around the dingy walls and to the old black stove with the fire nearly out and then over everything the kitchen contained, trying to think how it would seem to have it bright and winsome and warm to suit Polly.
Oh, she screamed. Goodness, cried Polly, taking her head out of the old cupboard in the corner. How you scared me, Phronsie. Would they never go out? Asked the child gravely, still standing where Polly left her.
What? Asked Polly, stopping with a dish of cold potatoes in her hand. What, Phronsie?
Why, the candles, said the child. The ever and ever so many pretty lights.
Oh, my senses, cried Polly with a little laugh. Haven't you forgotten that? Yes, no, that is, Phronsie. If we could have 'em at all, we wouldn't ever let 'em go out.
Not once?
Asked Phronsie, coming up to Polly with a little skip and nearly upsetting her, potatoes and all.
Not once, Polly, truly?
No, not forever and ever, said Polly. Take care, Phronsie, there goes a potato. No, we'd keep 'em always. No, you don't want to, said Mrs. Pepper, coming out of the bedroom in time to catch the last words. They won't be good tomorrow. Better have 'em tonight, Polly.
Ma'am,
said Polly, setting down her potato dish on the table
and staring at her mother with all her might. "Have what, mother?"
"Why, the potatoes, to be sure," replied Mrs. Pepper. "Didn't you say you better keep 'em, child?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.